meant for an adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
3, 2, 1, go!
Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Loveline, coast to coast.
You're fired, Anderson. All right, what's up, you guys? This is Loveline. Ace Marcola is not here. My main man, Mayonnaise, he's still on vacation doing something. I'm Stryker.
In Europe.
Damn. Yeah. It goes everywhere.
For a car show.
Stryker. Thank you. That's better
if
like that.
Literally a millionaire, you too could go to Europe.
If I was literally a millionaire, yeah. I too could go to Vegas and spend it at Olympic Gardens.
Nice.
In front of me, 3/4.
That would be my mother.
It is?
Yeah, she's here.
I thought I saw her outside.
Yes.
I gave her a five.
5 cents?
$5.
Price has gone five times.
That is Thomas DeLong in front of me. DeLong from Boxcar Racer, also from Liquidated 2. And then...
thank you.
Anthony.
Anthony's here.
And David.
And David's very shy. He's not... He's just
you guys didn't give him a mic. Apparently.
I got two mics.
Yeah, you have two mics.
Well, kids like to hear
those
in stereo.
Aren't
break that beat down.
Now is this stereo?
Multiple intimate details about David.
You're going to?
No, I already have. I learned his dietary habits.
Well, the thing is usually you guys take calls from people outside, you know, like the city, the building. But we're going to be calling you from within the building about our own band member.
About each other.
About one.
Oh, he's the one.
Well, he's like healthy, but we think that there's a hole in his heart, and he's trying to fill it with protein shakes.
No. What kind of protein?
It's a simple whey protein. It's just simply because I am vegetarian. It's a quick, like, fix, kind of.
Semen? Like, I said semen, and you still went on and answered it.
No, is this your own semen?
We're both vegetarians, but he's actually a lot healthier than I am. But he always, like, takes his, like, shakes with him. Like, we went surfing the other day.
Yeah.
And he's like, damn. I'm like, what? This is a good story.
Why are we talking?
This is a good story. We went surfing the other day.
Yeah. Don't tell
and he's like, damn. I'm like, what? He's all, nothing. I'm all, what? I dig it out. He's all, I left my peanut butter and jelly sandwich on the top of my car. And I'm all, dude, I'll go make you one. And it wasn't like, no, don't worry about it. He's like, all right. So we walked inside my house. And I'm all, how much peanut butter? You're like, I'm put it on there. You like grape jelly? You
know, I like the way this has come back to haunt me because it was a lot simpler than that.
I know. So but
stoked.
I knew
you
when
so
I made.
To make me a peanut butter
I was. I was, but I knew when I was making it, I was like, this is going to be a good story later on for Loveline.
Yeah. That is ridiculous.
Oh, man. So how close are you to good surf, Tom, in your house? Right outside?
Good surf.
I'm about, how far away am I?
You're forever.
Like
he lives
10,
out in the country.
About 10 minutes.
Oh,
no,
not
I had to move.
Minutes.
I would live right on the beach if I wasn't to be bugged by people that want to kill me when I sleep. Apparently that happens when you're a musician and you sing love songs.
Do people want to kill you?
There's some people that want to kill me.
Nice.
We've had creepy people in the past that like to drive up and down my driveway.
Good times.
So I've moved further and further away from the beach, but I'm not that far, about 10, 15 minutes.
Oh, that's not that bad.
It's actually like 7 or 8 miles, but they're windy roads.
Close enough to make peanut butter sandwiches.
Yeah, close enough to eat one and keep you...
I heard Mark just had a baby.
Yeah, I did too.
Yeah, so did Tom. Where have
you know,
been?
Sky, Mark's wife was the booker for Loveline, talent booker for Loveline, the TV show, for years.
Yeah,
we knew Sky before they did.
I hope it's not your baby, is it?
No.
Okay.
No, my baby is really cute, and I've been thinking it might be Dr. Drew's baby.
Well, Tom, I do have something to tell you, Tom.
Yeah.
But you know what, though? Yeah, no, she's awesome.
That's good.
She's
and what's your baby? You know, if you want to reveal your baby's name.
Geppetto.
PB&J. PB&J DeLong.
Because her name is Geppetto, and I dress her up like a cricket. It's cute.
Very nice. All right, we're going to take calls, but first, Boxcar Racer, you guys, if you're watching TV later and you're going to watch the Jay Leno Tonight Show, you guys are performing on there tonight.
We'll be there and here at the same time.
How'd that go?
That is good.
It was rad.
Really? It was fun?
Fortunately, for the first time I've done a TV performance, this was in a key that was easier to sing in than the others. Not saying that I did it. Because there's only three, I think I might have even said it on the show before, there's only three things you can do. You can be sharp, flat, or in tune,
mm-hmm.
or in key or whatever, and I'm never this third one, the in key one. I'm always like sharp or flat. There's only three you can be, and I never hit that third one. I don't know.
But you did it okay today.
Yeah, I think you did very well today. I think you did really good.
I think
you
I
don't have to kiss up to him. The band's going well.
I'm not trying to kiss up to him. I'm just, you know, just giving him his props.
I know. All right, we're going to talk about your band as the night goes on. I'm sure all the kids want to ask you guys a bunch of questions about Boxcar Racer and the whole Blink thing. And where the hell is Travis? Is he in the building?
He's coming.
Oh yeah, he's on his way. All right,
he
Travis,
was looking
move
at
it.
A new book, a new band at the Troubadour or something.
Yeah, yeah. Travis is like in
the Transplants.
He plays in the Transplants. He has a record label now. He just did a bunch of nude modeling last week for Zoo News or something. And
nice. I saw those pictures.
Actually, you know what they did though? You know that magazine PETA for the ethical treatment of animals?
Yeah.
They sent over a mock-up of what they want him to do, and it's this guy that's naked, like with his arms around his head, like he's in the shower, and it says, "Beat your meat before you beat animals."
Before your meat beats you.
Before your meat beats you, or something weird like that. It was so rad.
Is he gonna do it?
No, I'd do it in a heartbeat.
He said he was gonna do it.
He's not.
That's what he said.
That'd be hot.
Well, he should do it. He should do it, but just not in the mock-up that they have. Not that.
And not even say PETA. Just put "beat your meat" on it.
He should put that on his license.
That'd be a rap. Beat your meat to this, and just have a picture of him like that.
Have you ever seen? Hey, stop. You know there's a meat packing plant up the street here.
Right.
Culver City Meat. Culver Meats.
Oh.
You know what their slogan is?
No.
You can't beat our meat. It says it on all their cars.
That's a good slogan.
That's a good slogan.
I like it. All right, let's.
David Leno would read. Yeah. I mean, David Leno would read. You
know? Jay Leno.
Jay Leno. David Leno.
Headlines.
Yeah.
All right, good. Drew. All right, it's 1-800-LOVE-191.
Can't articulate yourself any better than that.
Nope.
Just like that.
Where's that voice coming from?
Amanda.
Hell.
Hey.
What's up? You're 17.
Yeah.
She's all thinking. Hang on.
Go ahead.
I've gained a lot of weight in the last 6 or 7 months. About 30, 35 pounds.
How much did you start at before the 35 got added on?
Well, I was 5'5", and I was about 130 pounds.
So now you're 170.
Right, 165.
So what happened? My medication?
Yeah, I am.
What medication?
Well, I've been on just about every antidepressant there is.
It's one of the unfortunate and rather common side effects of psychiatric medications is weight gain.
The reason why I've been on so many is because they keep changing them, trying to get me to stop gaining weight.
Right.
That's
a good thing to try to do.
Why does that happen?
It just, you know, our appetite centers are chemically set, and these just monkeying with the serotonin receptors and whatnot changes the appetite centers. So you're hungry all the time. You can't be satisfied.
That's trivia.
Yeah.
So what's your question then?
My question is, I've been stressing out over this weight thing for a long time, and I've tried to make myself diet and exercise, and it's just so much added stress on top of everything else.
Yeah.
And I'm decided kind of the other day that I don't mind being fat as long as, like, you know, someone else won't mind, and, you know, I can get
there's always going to be
like
someone out there that doesn't mind you for who you are, no matter fat, skinny, you know, tall, short, or peanut butter and jelly before you go surfing. I mean,
right.
Whatever.
Yeah.
There's always.
Well, there are exceptions.
They just opened a new club, actually, for that curvaceous women.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Where?
Well, it's 2645 Overland at Boulevard. No, I don't know. I think there's
in
LA,
yeah.
And they're going to start a chain of them, like really big women.
But is it
like,
big? Huh? But you mean dance clubs? Or you
yeah,
mean,
dance clubs.
Wait a minute. I mean strip clubs?
No, dance clubs, not strip
people,
clubs.
Do you see what women can't go unless they're.
No, any size woman can go, but they are catering to the men that like big women. So big women go, they know they're going to feel comfortable.
Everything's about creepy guys. Isn't that a bum out?
Yeah.
And we're all creepy, and we still do it. You know, like all the things. Like, girls have to go through the gnarliest stuff because guys are creepy. So they start creating – they have places where guys sit down and look at naked girl like boobs. Oh, my God. And they flock there.
Right.
And then they have – little, hey, how about a dance club where, you know, women are overweight, you know, because there's going to be guys like that, too.
No, it's not based upon that, I'm sure. It's probably just based upon the fact that overweight women can go and feel comfortable just being themselves as
right.
opposed to going like it's a competition.
All right.
No,
like
but
it's not for creepy dudes.
But Tom has a point, is that the whole industry, whatever industry, whether you want to call it
anything.
Love or sex, is all about guys and their visual experiences.
Oh, it's gnarly. And the gnarliest thing is watch your lady walk somewhere and look at the guys look at her like,
right.
and it's just like and look at yourself look at
wait till it's your daughter.
Oh my God,
how's that gonna feel?
Oh my, I don't know.
Geppetto will be
but you know
Geppetto's gonna be like
Pinocchio. Oh my
it
God.
Can be just a natural like instinct for a man because you're looking at a pretty healthy young female that is
don't try and
ready to bear
up.
No, it's true.
Ready
it's like,
bear
it's, like
children?
It's a natural thing because you look at them as if they're healthy beings.
That
you know?
Is absolutely
like,
true. That you will automatically.
It is like
not
a,
just
look.
That they're super.
It's cool
sexy.
If lions do it out in Africa. You know,
right. But they humans
do
doing it.
But humans do. But you know, I guess it's kind of the same reflex, huh?
It's the same reflex. Except guys, we've sort of
We make money off it now and stuff.
Yeah, we've cultivated to such an extreme in this country especially. And then we've denied that it's there.
Yeah.
And insisted that women do the same thing when they don't.
Hey.
Look who walked in.
There's Travis, everybody, from 61 different bands.
How you doing, man? You doing well?
Well, we're sitting here talking.
No, you know, give him his mic. Give him a mic.
This is okay.
Tom, tell him what's going on.
Well, there's this girl, and she's on.
Tom.
What?
Give him a mic.
Share, dude.
I want to be in stereo. All right. Listen to this.
There's a girl.
There's this girl, and she's on antidepressants, and one of the unfortunate things is those types of medications can alter the circadian rhythms of the serotonin. Hey, this is not... I almost sounded good for a second. No, but what it does you gain a lot of weight, so she gained a lot of weight. But this is the thing. Are you still there?
She's on hold.
Well, yeah. Do they always feel hungry? Do they have to eat?
No, but it's hard when you really have a strong
hunger.
When your appetite center has been set at a different place. It wants to maintain your weight at a different place.
Amanda's actually still there. Amanda, I think the coolest thing you said, though, is that you're okay with being a little heavy right now. And she
just wants someone to love her.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's someone out there.
I'm wondering if I don't really do something about this, am I going to end up like one of those old lonely ladies with like 10 cats like in her own house? You know?
20 cats probably.
I guess it depends on if the medication does its trick or not.
Well,
you get over it or you see the right people.
That will help her be able to have an effective relationship. But Amanda, a lot of this is up to you. You can choose not to be the crazy cat lady.
I mean, I can't. If I choose to stay overweight and less stressed out... Is that going to mean that I'm not going to find a person that loves me?
If you're stressing about it so much right now, you're not going to find it. And you're going to be one of those crazy ladies that walks around the supermarket giving everyone the evil eye.
You have a bunch of rock stars saying that.
I think if you're going to do that, then it's just more than a man's going to love, you know, just more to love. I just think, I don't know.
You know, and also this is the biggest thing. Is at least for us, our whole basis of this kind of music is being an individual and doing your own thing, and trying not to care too much about what other people think or say. So I think it's just, you know, you have goods and bads with what you're doing right now, and you got to take some of the bad with the good. That medication's going to help you out, and I guess there's some bad stuff too, but that's with everything.
Amen. Karen.
Hi.
What's up? You're 14.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask Travis, how long did it take him to master the drums?
Wow, I'm still trying to master the drums. To this day, I still try to be better, and I practice every day, and try to be creative, whatever. So yeah, I'm not done yet.
Not done yet, right?
This is the beginning.
Does it take a long time?
Yeah, it takes a little while to build up your coordination and, like, develop a style. But, it just depends on how much time you spend with it, you know?
Hey, I saw this special on MTV where there was this kid tagging along. Is that your brother or something?
Yeah, it's my nephew. He's a stud.
Oh.
Why, you like him?
No.
Okay. I was gonna help you out, whatever.
I'm just being honest.
Okay, very good. All right, Karen, thanks a lot.
Okay, bye.
Travis, you're in three bands right now, correct?
Yeah, I am.
And they're all kind of on, you know, you got the Blink side, and then you got the Transplants.
Transplants?
With Tim,
yeah,
it's Armstrong.
They're all totally different,
mm-hmm.
Like crazy different. Like Transplants are over the top, like... talking about selling drugs and random stuff, like hanging out with your friends and drinking too much beer. Where, you know, Blink, obviously, my first band and most important, we sing about girls and relationships and real life stuff. And then Boxcar is Tom's darker side.
My darker, creepy side.
My more experimental side. So
the part that looks at women.
It's good.
Exactly.
Yeah, but I just witnessed the best band in the world right now. That's why I was late.
Where?
Who? I seen this band called The Kinnison at the Troubadour.
Oh,
they were
stupid.
They were so good, it was ridiculous.
They opened up for The Used or played after The Used.
It was like magical. It was ridiculous.
Wham got back together or something.
Damn, I hope they do. We could go.
Yeah.
I don't know.
George Michael was outside.
Paul. Paul?
Hello?
What's up? You're 19 on with Boxcar Racer on Loveline.
Hey, I had a question for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
Last weekend, I smoked quite a bit of opium, and I drove home from Washington back to Baltimore, and I started having crushing pains in my chest.
Great.
And it lasted for 4 hours.
Good time.
And I was wondering if the opium could have caused that.
Were you doing anything else? Any cocaine?
No.
Just opium.
But I was smoking, and I was... also smoking marijuana, and I was drinking.
What does opium do? What's the effect of that?
Opium's heroin. It's all same thing. It's just another opiate, and you can smoke it just like you can smoke heroin.
And that got you across the country driving?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
And then some.
And no, opium, in fact, if anything, usually would sort of mask symptoms of a heart attack.
Yeah, because it's like a painkiller.
Right, and we actually give opiates when somebody's having a heart attack.
Yeah.
Like, it's not something that causes that unless your respirations are so suppressed that you're not oxygenating. So that's not an opium-type effect. However, nor is it marijuana particularly, and nor is it alcohol. So you have to wonder if there's some stimulant there. It's usually cocaine or amphetamine that does that kind of thing.
No, I've been off stimulants for a while.
But, Paul, you've got big-time addiction going on here, and you're going to have to deal with that eventually.
Yeah.
Big time.
Yeah.
And now that you're graduating to opiates, which is the most serious form of addiction, the recidivism is high. The probability of living to 40 is low. It's something that you got to deal with. Okay?
Yeah, I'm not actually a habitual user. Actually,
yeah, but you're an addict, and you've graduated, and it'll be game on. Trust me.
How do you not be?
Well, when you're an addict, you can be. But he's an addict. Now he's an addict. He's been already
it's too strong. I don't. You've never heard of success.
You're not an addict, though. You know.
That's where you like max out, right? With heroin, that's like the gnarliest thing.
It's just the hardest thing to stop. Actually, it's not the most dangerous or the most addictive, but it just has the highest recidivism. People can't stop it.
What's the most addictive then?
Probably cocaine, really.
Really.
But again, the most serious form of disease of addiction is to opiates.
Yeah, you never see a success story in that. I mean, people getting up, whatever, but, like, you never hear about people, like, doing it and their life being fine and cool.
Oh, they're just casually doing opium.
Never.
No casual heroin.
Is it true cigarettes are harder to quit than heroin?
When they've gone into centers and done questionnaires to heroin addicts and asked them which would be more difficult, giving up cigarettes or heroin, they'll say cigarettes, but it's not.
Wow.
So, Brian.
It's bad, though.
Brian, what's up, man? You're 15.
Hey, wow. Adam. Drew, I mean, you got a great show.
Thanks, Brian.
Yeah.
Stryker's here.
Yeah, hey, Stryker.
Hey, Brian. Hey, Brian, I'm going to have to put you on hold for another 26 minutes there. All right, where are we going here? Okay, it's a question for you guys. Go ahead, Brian.
What's up, Boxcar Racer?
Hello there,
Adam.
Calling you like my idol. Like, seriously.
Sing it, dude. Like, what? What?
It's just a little scary.
It's not scary. I applaud you. For saying what so many kids have yet had the balls to say. No, I'm just
Yeah, you really, like, motivated me to start playing guitar.
Well, why is he your idol, Brian? What is it about Tom that makes him your idol?
Besides, like, the normal, like,
so David
thing.
Anthony and Travis can just destroy whatever it is you're
saying. Yeah, don't let them shoot it down.
I think he's got, like, the best sense of humor out of everybody there. That's,
he is right about that. But he speaks, like, the truth.
Or shoot that one down,
that's
dude.
That's true. You are always laughing at yourself.
Because I have a great sense of humor.
That's right. That's the
it's
point.
Funny, isn't it?
Well, what about when you guys play as Boxcar Racer? What is your stage presence like?
It's hard to say dick jokes when you're on stage singing about the end of the world.
Right.
I've already figured that one out. So I think the less talking, the better. But I don't know yet. We haven't
because
really
you want to be yourself on stage, and if you're
I'm trying to be somebody else.
Yes.
I looked in the mirror the other day, and I was like, you know what? I can't be that guy anymore. I want to be David. I want to eat the best PB&J ever. I almost cut the crust off for him.
Right.
I was going to do that.
Yeah.
I was like, that would have been a good
one. But he didn't like that.
He's getting so pissed right now. He's looking back.
No, he's looking for his PB&J because he knew I left it on the window.
No, it's time for a protein shake. What are you talking about?
No. Did you hear the alarm go off?
Every 2 hours.
What about the plans for Boxcar Racer? You guys are going to be touring smaller
clubs. Yeah,
smaller venues.
Yeah, we are.
Are you guys excited about doing that?
I am.
Smaller shows?
It's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just going to be it's fun. I mean, the whole reason for this is, you know, when we have some time to ourselves, just do something a little bit different and just a new experience that we haven't had in a while. So it'll be a lot of fun.
Do you guys get the big, fat, dope bus because you're coming from a big band? And are these guys reaping the rewards
I'm
of the big bus?
I'm going on a moped.
They get the bus, and Anthony and I travel in a van.
Oh, come on.
Yeah. No. For real, we have bikes. Yeah. Like, we have these awesome Mountain Dew 10-speed outfits.
Right.
And
Mountain Dew paid for them, yes.
Yeah, Mountain Dew sponsored us.
I'm so proud of you. You've arrived, Tom.
It's good.
We've made it, yes. And we bike across America. And the name of the tour is biking. Biking across America, oddly enough, is what it's called.
All right, on that note, Oliver, you're 13. You have a question for these guys or for some of them?
Oh, yeah. Hey, Tom and Travis.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. It's so awesome talking to you. I'm a huge fan of Blink and Boxcar Racer.
Well, thank you.
Oh, my
God. Hey, do you like my sense of humor, too? No, you don't have to go off on that. What's your question?
Yeah, the other guy, motivated him to play guitar. In fact, you motivated me to play bass. Because my dream is to jam with you someday. So I got a bass guitar around July 4th, and I can play about, like, 20 Blink songs now. And
yeah. Hey, but what he's not saying is that he was trained in jazz and classical bass rhythms for, like, his whole life. And so when he finally got this new guitar, he was able to, therefore,
adapt to
some of the harder Blink songs to play.
Because they're so scientifically written.
How old is he?
13.
He's played all of his songs. Hey, no, he's been playing for 13 years. You guys got it.
He's a prodigy.
Yes.
Okay. Well, anyway, my question is.
Well, anyway.
How does Mark feel about you and Travis having like other bands?
Good question.
Oh, I think he's totally fine with it. Actually, what we do in our spare time is just kind of what we all do in our spare time. That's why.
He's trying to raise a baby right now, right?
Yeah. And
Oh yeah. Congratulations about your baby, dude.
Oh, thank you. I have one too. I'm trying to raise one as well, but
I saw pictures of her on Blink182.com. She's cool.
Hey, you're 13.
Is he hitting on her already?
Yeah, like she's like 6 weeks old, and he's like, you know, hey, but no, but what we all try and just do different things in our spare time, and even in the little more spare time besides Boxcar Racer, Travis is out doing the transplants and, you know, trying to put together a record label and stuff like that, and so we all have different hobbies and different things to do. So everyone's really supportive of each other. It's awesome.
That's really cool. Now, is that the truth?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, it just seems...
People always think weird things,
yeah,
too. Like, I get, but this Boxcar Racer thing was never meant, honestly, to be a big production. It was just a full spur-of-the-moment thing. Like, hey, we had our first break, and so let's try and do something.
The only reason why it seems weird from an outsider looking in, and I know the answer to this, but you wanted to find the best drummer around. The best drummer was in Blink 182.
I knew without a doubt that there was hardly any time to do this record, and I knew if I called Travis, it would be done in a matter of days, you know, for the drum perspective. I mean, you could spend months on drums if
the guy,
and I just, that's why. And Travis digs the music, too, so it just kind of worked out. But, you know, we haven't really been doing anything, and it's started to grow on its own, so we're just like, okay, well, actually, let's get this band together, and let's do some stuff in our spare time. So.
Cool. All right, well, we have to take a quick break here on Loveline. We've got Boxcar Racer, Travis and Tom and David and Anthony are here. If you want to talk to them, 1-800-LOVE-191. If your penis is falling off, it's the exact same phone number. I'm Stryker for Adam Kroll and Dr. Drew. More Loveline after this.
Hi, this is Mark from Blink-182, and you are listening to Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew on Loveline. I have a really big dick.
We're back. That's right. Loveline is here.
Thank you, Mark.
Did you guys really play that on the radio right now?
Yeah.
You can say dick on the radio.
Yeah.
Wow.
Just late night or like...
Because dick really means know. Richard, right?
Yes.
It's not one of the seven words you can't say. It's not.
And it's how you say it, too, I believe.
It's in context. There's no other way to describe that anatomy. It's important that we bring the anatomy up.
Exactly. And you being the doctor on the show, that's why we can say it.
I give you that license.
Boxcar Racer is here. And before we get into some more calls, we're going to hear a song from their CD, which came out, I think, in May, right?
Yeah.
And they're doing a tour. We're going to give some of those dates after this. Here's I Feel So, Boxcar Racer on Loveline.
Wish I was stronger, wish I could feel no pain. Wish I was young, wish I was shy. I wish I was honest, wish I was you, not I. Cause I feel so mad. We'll I was smart. I wish I made cures for how people are. I wish I had power. I wish I could lead. I wish I could change the world for you.
Racer, I feel so. If you listen to any alternative rock station, you've heard that song a million times, but the entire CD came out in May. And you guys, Boxcar Racer, are going to start off a tour in Tucson, which is my old stomping ground. So thanks for going to a smaller city to do that. They're going to be in Austin, going to be in New York, Chicago, Salt Lake, then back in L.A. November 23rd and November 24th at the Wiltern in Los Angeles, and a bunch of dates in between.
Yeah, I think actually San Bernardino is now going to be our first show on the 22nd of October.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Where are you going to play in San Bernardino?
We're going to actually try to change that. I was talking to Anthony.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, it's at this place where you go, and maybe one of your friends could get shot or stabbed on the way into the club. So we're not really into playing there anymore. Yeah. Maybe we'll switch to the Glass
House. It's not a very good...
The Glass House is a good place.
House is fun. We should do that then. I don't want
to... Yeah,
that's
Glass
like
House
like my our old neighborhood, too, like San Bernardino, Fontana, but it's just a bad place.
Yeah.
I don't want to... This is just me.
And Tom won't come if it's a bad place.
No, it's not. It's just I don't want to get stabbed or shot.
No.
Just you. Now, just speaking for yourself.
This is just me speaking for myself.
Anybody else who wants to get stabbed or shot, you're okay.
You know, you're entitled to your own desires.
Right.
What have you.
Of course.
That's nice.
All right. Let's take some calls here. Bill, you're 22? Hello? Who's this?
Hi, Bill.
Speak. Okay, Bill's...
Wait. We need... we're having a problem with our computer.
This our whole screen is off. I'm just guessing names.
They've got to bring in...
Sarah, you're 70.
Here we go.
Sarah.
All right. Line 2.
Yes, who's line 2?
Carolina? 16.
Hello.
Hi, you're 16 on Love Line.
Hi.
You all right?
What's up?
Sorry, I've been crying.
What's going on?
My boyfriend just broke up with me 3 days ago.
How long were you with him?
It would have been 9 months today.
9 months.
I hate...
16.
I hate crushes, you know? Like, when you hit your heart... There's nothing worse than getting your heart broken.
Better now than later.
That's true.
And you're only 16.
Yeah.
But you know what, though? That doesn't help.
Oh, you're only 16. Yeah, totally helps, because it makes you wiser, experienced.
Well, you know what? Anything that doesn't kill you makes you stronger, that's for sure.
You stole that from Daniel today, huh?
No.
Okay, I'm just wondering.
No. I heard that from, like, Field of Dreams or something like that. I have, like, these big, giant cutouts of Kevin Costner. Sometimes it helps me through tough times. And so, you know what, though? You know what? I think the doc should speak on this one as well.
No,
this is what I'm thinking.
Go ahead. Because
I write songs about this. You know what? You think that you'll never, ever, ever love again. You really do think that. But the reality is you will. And each day that you wake up, it's going to hurt a little bit less and a little bit less. And one day it won't hurt anymore.
Yeah, today I just woke up and it felt the worst.
I know. And you might have a couple bad days here and there, but it will get better. And there is somebody else out there that will
be like more stoked on you than this guy ever was. I was nicer than this guy ever was. My sense of humor.
There's so many
so
other
many
dudes
things.
Out there.
No, but there is. There's
Why'd you break up, Carolina?
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah.
Because I slapped him.
Because you socked him?
I slapped him.
Why'd you slap him?
Because he was trying to overpower me.
Physically? Like holding you down or something?
No, he pushed me.
Why'd he push you?
Because he said I was getting in his face. And I was not getting in his face.
Well, you right.
well you're better off
that.
Then.
So yeah. this is a Corona.
Do you come from a family?
Well, she lived. Not enough.
Do you come from a family where people pushed and hit each other?
My grandfather used to spank.
All right, so it's not okay to do that. And when you're in a relationship where that starts to happen, that is just the beginning. This is a relationship that not only needed to end, it must end. It is abusive, it's inappropriate, it's violent, and you should count your blessings. I understand it hurts, and I understand you love this guy, but this is not a good relationship, and you will see that someday.
Yeah,
you just tell him to kick rocks. Anyone who puts hands on you and you're a girl, that's horrible.
That is not a
horrible.
Path. Once guys have crossed that path, listen to me, Carolina. It keeps going. It gets worse.
Okay.
So he's a despicable asshole.
He's a despicable asshole.
He's a dick.
He wouldn't have done it, too. Like, he wouldn't have done that if he wouldn't have done other things, too, later on, you know?
Yes.
Like, he wouldn't just, like, shove you and stuff. I mean, he would actually hit you sometimes.
Oh, it's going to snowball into something.
He tried to strangle me, though.
He tried to strangle you.
Now, why would you even want to be with a nut like that?
Because it felt good.
Because I had sex with him.
Oh, well, that makes sense, then.
I got pregnant.
Yeah, so, listen, Carly, that does not make any goddamn sense. And
wow,
I understand.
Wow, he said the GD right in a row. Damn.
True. Thank you.
Wow.
You're impressed with the words we can use in the show, aren't you? You've done this show 400 times. What's the matter with you? But listen, just count your blessings. You grieve the loss. These are normal feelings, good feelings. They're awful feelings, painful feelings, but you will get through this. And next time, do not have sex with a despicable asshole.
She said, did you say you got pregnant?
Almost.
I almost got pregnant.
Called him a despicable asshole.
Yeah.
Oh, I also have
You could say that word, too.
Hey, you're going to have sex a lot more, like, in your life, and you're not even going to care about this one.
And he won't
like
hold you down, hit you, or tumble you.
But be careful with you and your instincts, because you were abused by your granddad physically, and you're going to be kind of attracted to guys like that, so be cautious, all right?
True. So if some guy just starts out as a slapper, which isn't good, more than likely, he's going to go worse than
once
that.
Once guys cross that threshold, they keep going.
Okay. So, Carolina, take that advice right there. Computer not working, so we go confusion. Amelia?
Yes?
What's up? You're 14.
Yeah. I'm trying to figure out what is society's problem with a 14-year-old and an 18-year-old being together.
The society does not have a problem.
What?
The laws are there to protect the 14-year-old. Because when you're 18 and you come to know, when you look at your peers and think, what kind of
a-hole
would be with a 14-year-old?
Yeah, it's gnarly. There's no 18-year-old that is considered cool that's dating a 14-year-old.
No.
None.
Or normal.
Or
it's
normal.
Creepy.
It's weird. You'll never know an 18-year-old.
At 14, you won't know that. But at 18?
When you hit 18 and you look at someone else's 18.
I hope she's 14. Is she not the 18-year-old?
Erica, you're the 14-year-old.
Okay, well, the thing is...
You're 14, right?
Mm-hmm.
Going on 30, right.
The thing is...
Okay.
The thing is...
My parents are getting a divorce. And at first, whenever we started going out or whatever, they both liked them. And then after they split up, me and my mom moved out. Because my dad was basically a dick while we were growing up and everything. And
there's that word again, Travis. You're right.
Yeah.
Where's my bourbon?
Anyway, and after we moved out, my dad all of a sudden had a problem with him because I don't know what it is. It's just
he wants to be dad now, huh? Now that he's gone, he's probably trying to get a tighter hold on the deal.
Yeah, but after we moved out, he's trying to use the fact that my mom still trusts my boyfriend.
No.
Against her so he can get custody of me and my sisters and her not get any visitation rights.
It's pretty gnarly.
But the thing is, we found a bunch of stuff against him that he doesn't stand a chance.
Well, look, the courts, it will probably ask you who you would like to stay with. That's
right.
One of the things that happen. So, look, this is a bad situation, and naturally enough, you're seeking refuge with what you believe to be a more secure and a more mature male. But in fact, when you're 18, you'll realize that there would be nothing more immature
an 18-year-old who would swoop in and
an 18-year-old guy, not only is he an a-hole, but he's not going to be going out with you to take you for a soda and a hot dog.
No.
I mean, he's
nor to help
you. He wants to make out, and that's all he wants from me. He knows you're easy prey.
Yeah, that's weird, no matter how you look at it. And think about how much you've changed since you're like 10 to 14. That's how much you're going to change when you hit 18, and then 21 and 22.
Well put.
God.
Well put.
21.
Ask her if she would date a 10-year-old.
Because you change that much. And then when you get out of high school.
I know you would, but I'm talking about you, Stryker.
Amelia, you would date a 10-year-old, right?
No.
Exactly.
All right, it's the same idea.
Right. Let's go to Kayla.
Hey.
Hey, what's up? You're 15.
Yeah, hey. I had a question for Tom.
Yes.
Hey, Tom. I'm from San Diego, too.
Okay.
So, yeah, just wanted to tell you.
619.
909.
Not anymore.
760. I'm up from the 858.
When's the last time you lived in 619?
A long time ago.
When that was the only area code in San Diego.
When that was the only one. That's true.
Yeah, okay.
And Oceanside.
Well, thanks
and
for your
San
call.
Clemente.
Is that it?
That's it. Thank you for your call and the area codes.
Tom, okay. Congratulations on your daughter.
Well, thank you very much.
No problem. And I just want to know how your relationship with your wife has been so far. I mean, sexually and, you know.
Yeah, there we go.
Okay. Well, every once in a while, I like small pieces of furniture in my butt. That's only if I'm hot. No, I'm just joking. No, why? It's good, I guess.
I mean,
we have a daughter, don't we? We had to make that.
Yeah.
And that's the best part about a kid is like all the practice. Because a guy's dream is like the quickie. Uh-huh. And you get a bunch of those when you're trying to make a kid. Right. You know what I'm talking about?
Uh-huh. Okay, sure.
Oh, wait. Maybe you don't.
Well, I was kind of looking at the dudes. Do you know if the baby was conceived on the road, at home, on a hammock?
It was conceived at home.
Okay.
During a planning stage of the conceiving stage.
This is when they were measuring the temperature and plotting it on the calendar.
Yeah.
And going, you've got to be home from the tour on this day.
Yeah. It was like that. Yes?
Do you remember Brie Cheese when you guys were on the road home on MTV?
No.
Brie Cheese, you called her and you told her that her name was the type of cheese.
That was like Brie?
Yeah.
Oh, wait. We got her letter from our taco place,
yeah.
Sombrero.
Yeah, she's my friend.
We're a big fan of tacos.
You get Mexican food from Sombrero.
Sombrero, yeah. We put in some songs and stuff like that. And
where are Sombreros?
It's in San Diego. And so now we get like fan mail and stuff there. So one day we went in there and I was getting a famous burrito that I always get there. We actually gave them a gold record, but some kid ran in and stole it. but we get fan mail there and I got one and I called this girl and said hi. Her name was Brie, and I thought it was similar to Brie cheese. But, right. You know, that's more for classy intellectuals like myself that eat soft cheese.
Very
crackers.
Highbrow humor here.
All right, yeah. We're going to talk about Ritz and more cheese and boxcar racers here. We got all the guys from the band in the studio here. That's Drew M. Stryker and more Loveline coming up after this. Hey, we're back on Loveline. I'm Stryker in for Adam Carolla along with Dr. Drew, boxcar racers here. And 40s of Mickey's are being passed around rapidly. No. What is that? Oh, that's apple juice. I'm sorry.
This is a 40 of apple juice. Treetop.
0.1%
juice.
In San Diego, when you lived in the 619, do you know a girl named Lee Hefner? Lee Hefner. Possible makeout in the early 80s?
Oh, I did make out with him. It's Hugh Hefner's brother.
No, it's a girl.
Lou Hefner?
Lee. No. L-E-I-G-H.
No, I don't. But
yeah,
for enough money, I'll kiss my own father on the tongue.
What about for free?
I'll do it for free, too.
There you go.
For enough money or for free, I'll kiss my own father.
All right. 1-800-LOVE-191 is the phone number if you want to speak to these guys or ask any questions that are on your mind. Let's go to Jasmine. You're 15.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Me and my dad are always arguing about everything. And, like, I don't know why, but we are. And he says I'm just, like, trying to disrespect him and everything, and I'm not. It's just we always are fighting.
Well, you're 15 for one, so...
How old's your dad?
17.
44.
It doesn't really matter, but my point being that I guess you're kind of...
it's my birthday tonight. Tomorrow.
No, it's not. Yeah, tonight right now.
Because I'm turning 44.
We were both thinking the same thing. Yeah, someone deserves spankings, and it's going to be...
Thank you. You in the butt. It's all
happy birthday, Dr. Drew, tomorrow.
Yeah,
happy birthday.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
How are we going to celebrate in here tomorrow?
I don't know, but I don't think we are.
Well, we'll bring a cake or something.
Hey, but I have something to say about this issue, though.
About the parents and the...
I plan on myself being the new father that I am.
I plan on taking dad parenting classes.
Good.
One of the coolest things that I learned that I never had as a kid was that when your parents respect you as a child and listen to you and kind of just back you on the things that you know, like even if it's wrong, they just listen to you and hear your side of it and go, hey, you know, I understand, but this is the way it should be because of my experience. That'd be cool. It makes you a better parent. And like I know some families have done that and they're like crazy close to their kids.
It actually, just doing that makes your brain, the child's brain, grow.
Yeah?
All you have to do is be present with your child and connect in a real way over whatever it is that's on their mind.
And Jasmine, your dad's not really listening to you, I take it.
Excuse me?
Your dad doesn't listen to you.
Well, I mean, it's not that he doesn't listen to me, it's just we don't like agree on anything. Oh yeah, and Tom, we have the same birthday.
Oh, really? Oh, so you're Sagittarius. Okay, then there's nothing wrong with her. It's all the dad.
Of course.
Yeah. Because she's Sagittarius.
Yeah, it's your birthday, so.
But in either way, I think there's a give and take for both you guys. You got to be understanding that he will never, not never, but it's hard for him to understand your position. And he's got to, like, be like, okay, listen, I can't, you know, I can't know everything all the time, like probably most dads think they do.
But I feel like, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it's the reality of the age also. I mean, for me, 15 to 18, I'm as much as I loved my parents, we couldn't quite click. Like, me and my dad were always, wasn't coming home on time, just stupid little things, but it just always at ends.
I feel like when I have kids, I'm going to be somewhat of a cool father understanding them. I don't know. I mean, and you said, Tom, that you feel the same. I mean, is it the generation, like, guys?
Well, it's kind of a cooler generation now, I think.
Yeah.
I think just because the information age, people are exposed to so much more, and we're a little bit more liberal with our way of thinking. And well, you know, we're in California too. We're much more accepting of individualism. I mean, that's the topic of tonight.
Individualism?
Yes.
Well, it's how you write the songs, right?
Yes, exactly. But
being
I don't
individual.
Know.
But now, listen, yeah, I've had to do a radio show for several years with a guy that was raised by liberal hippie parents, and he is the most bitter,
he hates
annoying person.
Yeah.
You have to be present, and kids need lots of structure. Lots of it. It's like raising a puppet. You know,
I'm scared to death. I got this little girl, and she's going to just walk all over me. I don't know what to do.
Just read all the parenting
books. Have, like, 20 girls.
I have triplets, two boys and a girl.
Triplets. Oh, God.
Imagine that.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
No.
Now.
I have one right now.
Yeah.
No wonder you're doing a nighttime show. You get out of the house at night.
Look, my hair was David's color when they were born.
Jesus.
Seriously. Dead serious.
That's why you get all the TV work now. Your hands.
How old are they now?
Gentlemen.
That's right. How old are they now?
10.
Silver Fox.
You got a few more years and then you're going to
pass. I'm just effed after that.
Oh, my God.
You know what's nice about this show? There's three different conversations going on right now.
Yeah. But you know what's good? They're all crazy rad.
They're
over there,
rational.
It's like, I hear Skippy Chunky is the best peanut butter I've ever had.
And someone just called you the Silver Fox, Drew. Alyssa?
Oh, yeah.
Alyssa, hi. You're 29. You have scary dreams?
Oh, yeah. Like, almost every night. And I just want to know if that can cause heart problem.
No. But what's your accent?
Huh?
What is your accent from? Where is it from?
Martian.
I don't want to say. That's silly. No, don't ask me that question.
You're not from the Valley, are you?
I need to know where you're from, and then we're going to ask some more questions.
Okay, I'm from California.
Originally.
Who are you?
No.
Well, we need to look.
What's your ethnic background?
We need to figure out why you're having these nightmares.
Asian. All right. Asian. Okay.
And you came over with your family?
Huh?
Did you come over with your family, or were you adopted over, or what happened?
No.
How did you get here?
It's a job.
I need to know.
You came here on a job.
Uh-huh.
You are.
She's
29.
A dancer. You have a sugar daddy.
What was your family of origin like?
I need to know what you're wearing to understand what's going on.
Brother.
What was your family of origin like?
Huh?
What was your family of origin like? What was your upbringing like?
You're doing something illegal, Lisa, aren't you?
Huh?
What are you doing?
Huh? I'm a nurse.
A what?
I'm a nurse.
Nurse.
What was your family of origin like?
What
was your family of origin like? What kind of circumstances were you raised in?
What?
Just the regular family.
What I'm getting at is that one of the more common reasons somebody your age would get recurrent nightmares is a post-traumatic stress reaction. And if you had experiences of powerlessness in childhood, that can sort of set you up for that.
Years later, it can?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Maybe because, like, I worry too much.
You what too much? You worry too much? That's all part of the piece. I just get post-traumatic
stress. But how come infants have nightmares? That's weird. Have you noticed that? being...
They wake up, yeah.
Oh, but you know what my theory is? Because they can only see, like, 10 inches from their face, and all day they have these humans with, like, 8 times bigger heads coming in, and they're going, whoa, good, 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 good. That would scare the shit out of me, too.
Oh,
oh no, oh, yeah, we can say all these other... We can talk about dicks and assholes, but... All right, caca, don't say caca. No, but infants, like, the other night, I finally put my daughter to sleep. Then just out of nowhere, screaming bloody murder. And I don't even know, like, it's like, and I
that may not be, these are, how old is she now?
6 weeks.
I think it's just neurological discharges. There's no self, there's no other, there's no image. Things are just starting to take form. These are just like having seizures almost.
Really?
There's discharges, drive discharges. To think about it in terms of our adult minds, you can't. It's a different thing altogether.
That's weird, man. Yeah. Nightmares are scary.
Yeah. Elisa, you do sound like a goofball, by the way.
Yeah, you're not going to tell it. Give us
no,
anything,
I know. So. I just want to know what... Give me one thing about what your dream's about.
Like, I'm in a cave.
Like with the guy from the Brady Bunch when he calls the statue Oliver?
All right. Like, and wow. Then there's the devil...
I'm the superhero.
All right, listen. If you want to do something about this, do. You're an RN. You know there's help for this kind of thing. Go ahead. It's okay to get help, right?
True.
Yeah.
Tell me about your family circumstances.
They're in the break. We got to
okay,
go.
Okay, all right.
When we get back, I'll talk about it.
All right. Well, you're supposed to say what and imitate her. Thanks
what?
For being my teammate
what?
On this. All right, Boxcar Racers, here I'm striking for Adam. That's true. More Love Line is coming up after the Ass Biatch. Here on Loveline. Hope you had a fun, long-ass Labor Day weekend at Stryker and Dr. Drew. I'm in for Adam Carolla on Loveline, as I said. Tom, Travis, David, and Anthony are here from Boxcar Racer. And this is by no means a side project to the Blink guys. This is the real deal, like full-fledged 100% effort all out.
We do everything with 100% effort.
This is a band.
It's a band.
Well, you know how people say it's unit. Their side project.
Well, I mean, I know. And
is Mark jealous?
In fairness to Blink-182, I mean, Blink-182 is our priority, you know. But we still put our hearts and effort into this, you know. We want everything. We don't want to put out a bad product ever.
No, of course
we're
not.
We're artists, you know. I'm going to cut off my ear in the making of this. You know.
That is Tom Van Gogh DeLong over there.
Yes.
And it's 1-800-LOVE-191. Travis, Jesse19 wants to speak to you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a question for Travis.
What's happening?
Hey, I live in Corona, and I just wanted to ask you, how did you come up with your clothesline ideas?
You know what? It was just me and a couple friends, like, whatever, getting into trouble and being creative at the same time, and just made some stupid t-shirts. And then it was more of like just like a little posse, and then it turned into a clothing company. For whatever reason, people liked it and wanted to buy it, so whatever, we just made it happen. It's still ran by me and my friends. We don't really know what we're doing, and we don't care. We're having a good time doing it.
What about the whole record label, Travis?
Yeah, I have a record label. I'm starting a record label, and I'm signing my favorite bands. I'm basically going to be like a mini, acting like a major. Like, I'm going to sign a hip-hop band, a speed metal band, a punk rock band, a spock rock band, you know, whatever I feel like doing. So it's awesome. It's cool.
What's the name of it?
It's called LaSalle Records.
Nice.
Spock rock's a rad...
Spock rock.
Way to describe so many bands out there, like, where they're like...
Spock rock.
They look like... They're from space, I guess.
Yeah.
I like it. Adrian.
Yeah.
What's up? You're 15.
Yeah. Hey, what's up? How you guys doing?
Good.
How
are you?
I'm doing good, I guess. But, yeah. Anyway, this is, like, basically for... It's an opinion, you know, for all you guys. Okay. Okay, well, I met this guy over summer, right? Okay. And I start school tomorrow. And then we started dating, whatever. And then he asked me out to be his girlfriend.
Uh-huh.
And he's my first boyfriend. My first boyfriend. And but we go to different schools. But we live in the same town. We both live in Fontana.
Yeah,
hey,
what
I grew up?
Up
there.
He,
I grew up there.
He goes to Fohai.
I like Fontana.
What's up with the IE Riders?
I like Fontana.
Yeah, exactly. I'd be going to Fohai.
You like Fontana?
I like Fontana.
Jim Rome. If I didn't, Jim Rome calls him Fontucky. I thought that was the raddest way to.
No. It's a. If I didn't grow up there, I would probably be a spoiled like.
Oh. Unappreciative. Yeah. Like us. Yeah. I'm not saying you are, but
Anthony's
going to
sell fun.
Yeah, if you're going to San Diego or something.
It made me tougher, and I look back on it, and I wouldn't have it any other way.
I love Fontana, dude. I love it.
Wow. Better back it.
Well, I like Poway.
Yeah. You know,
it's got a great school district. They opened
up a
Walmart.
Like, that gated community is rough out there.
Yeah. Yeah. Dude, it's so cool. I love it, but
Garden Road.
But see, the sucky thing is, I don't go to Full High. You know, I go to a new school they built here. It's called Kaiser High School.
Yeah.
It's big, huh?
It's huge. I love it. It's, like, really cool. But anyway.
It's the high school without the bars surrounding it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you go to Miguel's?
Huh? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I got sex there one time. It was great.
What was his name, Tom?
Miguel. So what's the owner-operator? What's the question?
Okay, now that we're going to separate schools and so we can't really see each other, like, anymore because, like, we can't spend time with each other, I was wondering, like, what do you think, like cool things we should just do to, like, be able to see each other, like, during the school year?
How far apart do you live? Is he 16?
Huh?
Is he 16 yet?
Yeah.
So does he have a car? Does he have a license?
No. Yeah, he has his permit.
Fontana days. Go to Fontana days.
The best thing to see each other, the best thing to be in contact now is, like, internet, I guess. It's, like, free for the most part.
But see, he's not into the whole internet thing.
Good. He's in Fontana. He doesn't have a computer.
He doesn't have a computer. Walk over to his trailer and just hang out with him.
I'm all best things like satellite phones because you have great coverage and, you know, for $3,000 you can get a great phone.
I'm just wondering because hopefully we can stay a couple. See, but bad thing is he already got on the bad side of my family.
That's not good.
Why would happen?
That's not good because he has a habit of promising me stuff like, "Hey, dude, get ready. We're gonna go to this concert. We're gonna go see this band. This local band's really cool. I'll go pick you up." And then I get ready and I'm waiting and he never comes.
That's a problem.
Adrian, he sounds like a great guy.
He sounds like this is another despicable prick. This is another one of these asshole guys that we have to
do for what you guys are. My dad are like already. They despise him already.
Yeah, you should give up on this guy. This is not good. This is not a boyfriend.
Maybe he's just trying to get his stuff together, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I do stuff like that once in a while and whatever.
Yeah, he's super cool though.
No, you don't do like that's gnarly.
No, there's times like whatever.
Like if you really like a chick and you respect her or whatever, you're like, don't even call.
Maybe he likes her so much he's playing games.
Yeah, he's 16.
I'm gonna bring something up too. Is that he went to Arizona like 2 times this summer, and like he never called me once.
Okay, I changed my mind. Never mind.
So why do you think he's your boyfriend then? If he's going to Arizona, not calling, saying he's gonna come pick you up, and doesn't even show up.
And why are you
up?
Laughing about this?
Well, maybe he went to Sedona, Arizona, and saw some UFOs and had a spiritual enlightenment.
Yeah, but see, like I don't know. He told me he went for a good reason, which is
Sedona. I mean, some
UFOs.
People, well, you can go out there and sit with the Indians and look at the stars. And
I guess so. Whatever it was, he must have liked it.
Has he already cheated on you?
He hasn't cheated on me yet. No. We haven't cheated on each other yet. Because we're really, like, I told him straight out. I said, dude, I'm not, okay, I don't feel good. Okay, how would you feel, dude, if, like, Jesus. If you're with somebody and you didn't know that they're cheating on you? You know, we have, like, this, like, respect for each other, you know, we're...
Yeah, he's obviously showing you tremendous respect, setting you up on dates and then not showing up.
It's, like, a waste of time if you're going to just cheat on me. So we tell each other straight out, like, you know what, you know, if I was to cheat on him, I'd tell him straight out. Be like, you know what, dude, I cheated on you because... You know, I tell him straight out, but I wouldn't do that.
Isn't that rad, though? You know, in relationships you get into, you go, just tell me if you do it. You're totally. Yeah.
Just tell me, dude. If you don't like, if you're not feeling the relationship, just tell me.
Nine dudes so far. Adrian.
Yeah. Adrian, there's no way he's going to tell you anything. Yeah. Just accept that. Okay?
Yeah, he wouldn't call you.
No way.
He's not even telling you when he's in the 520 in Arizona.
Yeah. Yeah, he's got to be honest and straight up with you, and then you guys can have a healthy relationship.
He's totally straight up about it.
No, he's not. Adrian, he's not.
Not if he's disappearing to Arizona.
Yeah, and you're starting a new school year, so there's going to be more boys.
There's
going to
be lots of picking
dudes everywhere.
This is one of those guys I guarantee he's going to end up on Cops in about 5 years,
beating his neighbor's mailbox with a baseball bat.
I would love to see that guy naked, you know, and just really examine him and just say, hey, you know, what are you all about, mister?
Oh, that would be fantastic. Kyler.
Yes.
What's up? You're 14.
Just want to say, Tommy, you're my freaking idol, dude.
That's too idle so far.
Now, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this call, guys, but I think we should kind of go into some of the reasons.
Anyways, Tom, I have your car. I love it, dude.
Thank you very much.
Teamwork, Duncan, and Bader, dude, all the way.
It's a good-sounding guitar.
It is. It's sick.
It was funny. I play Fender guitars, and not because I know my scales that they want to make or replicate my guitars, because they thought I actually came up with a cool concept, but it actually is doing quite well over there. But I think
Fender
the people
pants.
That
Guitar pants?
Guitar. It's guitar pants, yeah. It's like certain pants to wear to help you play guitar better. And, yeah, they're just kind of baggier, and they give you support where you need it. But
And doesn't Mark have his own bass?
Yeah, he does, actually, as well. Yeah, it's a good bass guitar, too. I don't know, but thank you very much for the compliment.
Yeah, anyways, I was wondering, what kind of amplifier do you use?
I use a mixture of stuff. I use Mesa Boogies primarily, but I use Marshalls as well, and I kind of mix them together, because they kind of seem to add to each other. What one has, the other doesn't, so it kind of works out nice that way. Okay, who's the idol?
All right, Kyler, is there any more?
No.
Thank you very much. Take it easy, buddy.
Thank you. Bye.
Did you call everyone buddy?
Only if that's their name. What was his name, buddy?
I don't know.
Oh.
Kyler.
Thanks, buddy.
Ted.
Yeah. The buddy, what's up, man? Dude.
You're 16.
Yeah?
What's your question?
Oh, I had a question about my dad was abusing me and drinking and hitting and stuff. Great. I want to know if I should move in with my girlfriend. She's got her own place.
You're 16. How old is she?
19.
19? How did you end a 19-year-old? 16, I didn't even know what a girl was. Well, I knew, but...
That should mark out all the bad things in your life just there. Like, you have a 19-year-old? Hey, I want to hear the doctor's answer on that.
Well, I was just thinking about how we just completely raked over the coals a young lady who was 14 dating an 18-year-old. Now is a dude with a 16-year-old, 19-year-old.
It's cool.
Like, awesome. Oh, right on.
But I'm sure she works at the supermarket, like, has the best job and everything.
Where is she living with her parents?
Nah, she's got her own place. She's in college.
Oh, my God. Why don't you call social services about your dad's behavior?
Huh?
You ever thought about that?
Probably just want to get in the mix with it. You know how it gets gnarly? Why would you want to inflame the situation? That'd probably... Well, I know it's the right thing to do. It just seems like it'd be hard, you know?
The idea is not to inflame... Yeah, I understand you're sort of trying to fly low and, you know, not inflame the guy, but he's an out-of-control alcoholic.
Where's my bourbon?
You need to bring in some structure. And when he gets out of control, you call the police.
All right.
There's got to be consequences for his behavior, and someone's got to...
That's not right.
Someone's got to get him to the point where he's willing to get some treatment for his disease. Because if he sobers up, he won't behave like this.
Would your dad freak if you moved in with this 19-year-old?
I don't know if he'd even notice.
Really?
Wow.
So, Drew, I mean, should he even bother
them? You've got to make decisions that are good for you. Yeah, you should.
Yeah.
I mean,
if he's not going to notice the kid even moving out.
Do you have any counselors at school or anybody you can talk to about what's available for you?
I got some guidance counselor, but I don't really want to talk to them. They don't do much.
Well, maybe just sit down and talk, see if they have any ideas. You need to make some choices that are good for you. Are you going to be able to get out and go to college, that kind of thing?
Yeah, my grades are pretty good.
All right, you're how old now?
16. You're going into 11th or 10th?
I'm a junior, 11th.
So you got two more years. Can you hang with the 2 years and get to a college or something?
All right.
The guy's like, if his dad's hit and
what about like grandparents?
It's gnarly. I don't even know what to say, but my first thing would be like, get the hell out of there if you can. But it's hard. You're 16.
He's not an emancipated man.
Start a band.
But the guy's
play music.
Hitting him. What do you do about that?
Call the police every time.
I got a question about that for Tom.
What's that?
I gotta decide on this name.
For a band?
Yeah, I got two. Tell me what you think. All right, 12 Gauge Valentine.
That's a good name.
Independent Youth.
No, 12 Gauge Valentine. 12 Gauge Valentine is kind of emo, and Independent Youth is more of a hardcore kind of name. But early, it sounds like elementary. But 12 Gauge Valentine sounds cool. I think. I don't know. I'm going on a limb here. I think it sounds cool.
me and my friend are trying to decide.
There's another one that you can use.
What?
My penis tastes great. That's more of like a slogan. It might not even really work.
Yeah, that's just a statement of fact.
That just could be just something you put on a T-shirt and wear around. But I don't know. But I think that's a good. I think that one is good. But yeah, as far
Ted,
as
you really need to deal with your living situation. Where's your mom?
She's just ignoring it.
Oh, she's at home?
Yeah.
Oh, this is a mess. You gotta talk to your mom about this too.
Is your mom sane in at all?
What?
Does your mom have any sanity in her at all?
I don't know. She's like a sane person outside the house, but...
So your dad's got her wrapped around his finger.
Yeah.
Do you want to try to help your dad?
I don't know. I just want to get out.
Yeah, but you got two more years and you'll be out of there. I mean, just get your grades up. Stay out of the house as much as possible. You know, do sports and hang out with your friends.
That's actually a good take. Like,
and avoid him like crazy.
Hang out with the lady that you're into and get to, you know, be into music and sport, whatever it is, you know, and just concentrate on hanging out with your friends and get the hell away from him.
Yeah, and if he acts up, you call 911. That's it. There has to be consequences to his actions.
He's going to be bummed when he wakes up in jail one morning and goes, okay, now I know, you know. Your mom's got to step it up, too. What's she doing? Why is she just kicking it like that?
I don't know.
Yeah, well, at least you have 12-gauge Valentine now.
Yeah, that's a rad band name.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah.
Hey, there's another band name. Vasectomy, Vasectayou. Or Colostomy, Colostayou. Any of those two would be good.
Oh, hey, one more thing.
Yeah.
So up and down. Atticus? I love this. Yeah.
What's that, Ted?
What's Atticus?
It's just it's a clothing company that's music-oriented. Punk rock bands and emo core, hardcore bands, that kind of thing. And rather than being a kind of a clothing company that's based around board sports like skateboarding or surfing or whatever, it's based around music musicians, and it's inspired by them.
Is that it?
That's it. But I have a and thank you.
Wait, when Take Off Your Pants and Jackie came out, was one of the names you were going to use the diarrhea of Anne Frank?
Yes, that was it. Or Genital Ben, and have, right. And have a big bear on the cover.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
We have some good ones.
That. Yeah, those are so funny. Let's see. There's a question here for you guys. Dino.
What's up?
What's up? You're 18.
Hey, Travis.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you a question about your Cadillac, dude.
All right.
I have a 72 Chevy, and I want to fix it up, but I'm 18. I'm kind of broke. What would I do about going, like, fixing it slow, little by little?
I was pretty slummy. Like I had a
junkyards.
Like, if you like it, that's all that matters. Yeah, go to junkyards, find parts.
Yeah.
I've only worked on a car one time in my life.
Yeah.
And I had to change a fan belt, and I took it apart, put the belt on, and put it back together. And I had all these extra pieces, and I'm like, where the hell do those things go?
Oh, no.
So I started attaching things. I'm all, well, maybe the spring goes over here. My gas pedal was stuck, and I couldn't slow down. Don't do that.
Oh my God.
Car clubs?
What is that?
Are you from any car clubs?
You know, me and Anthony, the guy in a boxcar with me, we had a car club called the Ruins, but
it's still existing. And we all got to step it up, and you know who we're talking about.
Yeah, and just go get one of your friends to like heat your springs, and your car will be way too low to the ground, and get some white walls, and Mercedes.
Do it yourself. You'll learn that way.
Yeah, put your seat back.
Travis.
Yeah.
Your girlfriend looked way, way better than the last one.
What'd you say?
Your new girlfriend looks way better than the last one.
How do you know who my new girlfriend is?
I saw her on VMAs.
Oh, yeah. Well, thank you. I like her way better, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, then.
Thanks. All right.
That's good. And on Jenny Jones tomorrow, Travis will be on there hanging out. It'll be really, really, really good. All right. Boxcar Racers here, and we're talking to Chelsea.
Hey.
What's up? You're 17. Hey.
That was nice. Yeah, we're all okay. We're listening now.
What's up?
Yeah, when I was 12...
This is going to be bad, probably.
Yeah, it is.
Go ahead. Yeah, it's sad. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine.
My grandpa molested me for, like, 5 months.
Mm-hmm.
And, everyone knew about it in my family. My parents, my brother, my grandma, and,
How did they all find out about it?
I told them.
You told everybody?
Everyone.
And then, after it had been happening for a while?
Yeah.
Okay. And what did they do?
Nothing.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man. She sent us a Samoan mafia after him.
Yeah, that's horrible.
And, like, my grandparents, like, even went to marriage counseling, like, with the pastor at their church.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I guess by law he's supposed to, like, tell on them, but he didn't, like, so nothing at all has happened.
That is...
How do you feel? Obviously, you want this guy to be
or
put
do
away.
You?
I mean, do you? I mean...
Well,
how do you? What do you want to happen to him, if possible? What did you expect to happen when you told everybody, and what did you want them to do?
I thought that somebody would like care about it. Like my parents would try to comfort me, or like.
What did they? What'd your parents say?
They were like, "Oh, well, it's probably your fault." And
no,
they did not say that. They did not say that.
Because like, I would go over there and like just sleep, like on the couch and stuff, and like pretty much not wearing very much, and so.
Whose father was this?
My mom.
Your mom. So he undoubtedly did this to your mom, too. And so when...
No, he didn't.
Oh, I would be very surprised if he
did. No, she told me about a lot of stuff, and, like, her uncle molested her and stuff, but...
All right, so the point is that I'm trying to make is that your mom was abused, too, sexually abused.
Yeah, all right.
And that for someone that has been through that kind of horrible trauma, their levels of denial can be profound. And they tend to keep victimizers around them in their lives, so your dad kind of worries me a little bit, too, frankly. But be that as it may.
If that happened to my daughter... Oh, I'm sorry.
What? Jesus.
No, but I would be like, but you know what I'm saying. You'd kind of go, I would start killing people.
You'd go,
and if this dad's just kicking it,
Yeah.
Especially, whose dad is it? Is it his or your
mom? No, it's mom's. The mom's
yeah, oh, my God.
And the mom had been sexually abused by
What is your dad doing boyfriend. Through all this? What's he
Come
saying
on.
To you?
You know,
yeah. Well, why isn't he freaking?
My beat down.
Dad is, like, sick. He has cancer and stuff. He can't really do very much about it.
Oh, your dad
is? Yeah. He may, so be, there's a, some he may be some kind of an abuser, too, because after, like, mom picked him.
Wow.
Your mom was sexually abused.
I love how, like, deep you can, like, think in it, you know? I never
yeah,
thought of somebody.
Yeah, he's definitely out there. Like, he's been on heroin most of my life.
There you go. Oh, okay, so now...
Mom all... gets abused, so she finds an abuser.
Yeah, so
hey, I have a total idea. Why don't you just, first thing in the morning, call the police and just go, this is what happened, and I want this taken care of, and I want this out of my life, and they'll direct you some good people and get it...
Yeah, Department of Social Services. That's really the only way this is going to change. You can go to Al-Anon. You're dealing with addicts all over the place here, undoubtedly. And you can get a sponsor and get some support, and they can help you make these decisions and help guide you.
There's no way it can hurt you. I would think it would do only good.
Chelsea, you got a lot of trauma to deal with here. You also have a genetic history that suggests you might, you know, at least have a possibility of inheriting the addiction, right?
Right, yeah.
Do you think you're an addict? Do you have that momentum with things?
Yeah, I think, yeah.
Okay, so you have trauma, addictive genetics. That is usually what adds up to addiction, and you've got to be very, very careful with this.
Well, my question really was, like, am I, like, supposed to be over this by now?
No.
How old were you when it happened?
12.
Listen, this kind of trauma etches a biology into your brain that you have to deal with for a long, long time. And to some extent, it leaves scars that never leave. You've had no treatment. You've had no opportunity
right.
to get through this, and you've had not even an acknowledgement from your family that you've been through this horrible thing.
And when you say treatment, that could be a number of different things, huh? Like just talking about it.
And for a long time.
For
a long, long time. And just having a heroin addict dad is something you need to do.
Yeah.
And,
do you think that contributes to, like, why I want to date, like, older guys?
Sure, and addict guys, too. You probably go for really...
Why does that happen?
That's just the way we're wired.
Like sometimes, like you were saying earlier, if somebody is abused, they tend to want to be around that.
Abusers, yeah, they tend to. No one really knows. They try to make sweeping generalizations about it being people trying to make it right. You know, they love that person
that
was their dad, and so they go to somebody that's like that because that's what they love, and they're going to make it good this time. But I think the reality is we just get that stuff wired into our brain. It just fits. And that's what drives us.
That's why you see the cycles in the families, because the girl gets abused by the father. She finds an abuser. He gets her pregnant. They have a kid. Now that kid is screwed up for life, and it's just a big-ass cycle. That's why I hear Adam screaming.
Don't have kids.
Yeah. Don't have kids, you morons!
Tom is going to end that cycle. Tom comes from a family of carnies.
Right. Of carnies.
Carnies? My mom's name's Connie. For real. But, no, it's crazy. Hey, kids are hard. They poop so much. They
so
do.
Is my dog.
They do. But yeah, but you can eat your dog's poop. You can't eat human poop. You get sick.
Except if they had corn the night before.
I know.
That's
crazy.
Good.
No, but you know what, though? Mm. I had a pretty good... child life or whatever. The only bad thing was that my parents got divorced, whatever. But I could just being a dad, though, all I want to do is be, like, the best dad ever. Like, I really, really want to. And it's just weird to think that other people can be so irresponsible.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But I, you know, whatever. I guess it has to do with
your lady is listening, she's got to be just crying.
And it's like,
joy right
I want
to
grow a flower for every time I say I love you to my daughter. And, like, no, I'm just joking.
All right. Well, then we have to take a break. Is that all right?
No,
it's okay,
not.
Tom Travis, David Anthony here. It's Boxcar Racer. You can call and talk to him. 1-800-LOVE-191. And more Love Line coming up after this. Back on Love Line. Guys are coming back in the room.
I should just play a song.
Yeah, I was just thinking that.
No, cannot have.
Not one.
You have a song ready, Anderson, so we can go to it in a minute?
Try this beverage.
Yeah?
No, right, cannot
cool.
have.
I'm not sure which song it's going to be.
What song are we playing?
No, cannot have.
Can you say it in my headphones when you get a chance? Boxcar Racers here. Striker in for Adam Carolla. In 2 days from now, Weezer will be in here. That should be cool. And then tomorrow night, Sherry Appleby from a new movie, Swim Fan?
Just know from Roswell.
And from Roswell as well. All right, we're going to hear another song from the guys from Boxcar Racer right now.
Another? Where was the first one?
We played it earlier.
You were taking a break.
You were out masturbating like always.
Well, that's what I do.
All right, we're going to play There Is. Song called There Is. All right, so here it is right now. Boxcar Racer, There Is on Loveline.
guess these white pills are kind. I've given a lot of thought on this 13-hour drive. I miss the grind in concrete where we sat past 8 or 9 and slowly finished laughing in the glow of our headlights. I've given a lot of thought to the nights we used to have. The days have come and gone, our lives went by so fast. I faintly remember breathing on your bedroom floor, where I laid and told you, but you swear you love me more. Do you care if I don't know what to say? Will you sleep tonight, or will you think of me? Will I shake this off, pretend it's all okay, that there's someone out there who feels just like me?
Excellent. Boxcar Racer, that is called There Is. They're going to be playing smaller venues, going on tour in Tucson on the 23rd of October. Go to the website. Is it boxcarracer.com, you guys? They can find out all the dates.
Yes, it is.
If you live in Chicago, they'll be there November 9th. L.A., the 23rd and 24th of November at the Wiltern. Are tickets on sale yet for that show? Do you know?
I don't know.
I don't think they are yet.
I don't know if they are or not yet.
Because when they are, I'm sure I'll be giving them away on my radio show.
You'll be giving them away and then some.
And then some.
Unless someone wants to buy one or two for promotion.
They can do that.
Like Pepsi or something.
For Pepsi?
Yes.
What do you mean for Pepsi? Let's see. Diana.
Ross?
It's Deanna.
Okay.
Yeah, Deanna. I beg your pardon.
This is Tomas.
Okay. Well. Hey, Deanna.
Excuse me.
We're going to have to put you on hold. Hold on. Okay, let's go to Kenny.
What's up?
You're 17.
Yeah, man, what's up? Hey, what's up, Tom? Travis?
What's happening?
Anthony. Hey, what's going on? It's Anthony.
David.
And David. There he said he got it. He got
what's
it.
What's up, guys? Yeah, you guys are in the band, too.
Ah.
I don't know. I just really wanted to tell, like, Travis and Tom, and I guess David and Anthony, too, since you guys are part of Tom and Travis's lives, that you... I mean...
Stuff.
And stuff.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
We try. It's nice to talk. You know what's cool about this show? You actually get to talk to your fans. You never really get to in a band.
And not just from this city. They're from all over the place, actually.
It's cool.
Like Deanna. You're 18 from Riverside.
Yes. Deanna.
Hey, guys.
How you doing? Good.
Okay, first I want to start by saying, Tom, I think you're a total sex symbol.
You know, that's not... Let's,
I like
let's
the way you respond
spend some
that
time
too.
On this. Let's spend some time on this and really.
Yeah.
Let's really.
I totally like fantasize about you. I think you're the key to orgasm.
Oh, the key to that, huh?
Really?
Wow.
Yeah. Hey, my dad said the same thing about me. No, it's weird.
Yeah,
hey.
It is weird.
Okay, my question
Thank
is
you.
For I think Travis or whoever can answer this. I heard that you guys that you were in a band called Boxcar Racer before this band.
Yes, I was.
And I was wondering, where'd you guys get that name?
It was actually me and a friend named Alex Beretta. He's a Riverside boy, too.
we had a band called Crawl with some friends, and then we had a band called Boxcar Racer, and I don't know, I was young, and I was just trying to start as many bands as I could, and I loved playing a band with Alex, but whatever, like, I started touring with other people, and Alex is still around. He plays in a band called The Good Boys in Riverside as we speak, like right now, and I was actually, he was one of the people I wanted to get together for Boxcar, but I couldn't locate him, but he's cool. Around now.
You know what's interesting about that name? When I was writing a lot of lyrics on this record, a lot of the lyrics are very biblical, like Revelations, end of the world kind of stuff. And there's a lot of people and a lot of books that have been written about World War II being the real-life scenario of the Book of Revelations and Armageddon and the Antichrist. And it's crazy. If you got into it, it's really gnarly about the coincidences. But the second bomb that was dropped on Nagasaki was from a plane.
Tom.
What?
You really want to say that?
No. Well, no, it's interesting because I didn't know this. It was from a plane called Boxcar. And it ended World War II.
Huh.
And it was weird because our, you know, Boxcar
there goes
Racer.
The neighborhood.
And then we had, no, but it's not a bad thing, though, because the war was ended by this, you know, whatever.
I don't believe
Yeah, I don't believe
that.
It is. I know, I didn't mean to, but Anthony, your voice is so high. But I don't know, it's interesting because I have so many songs on this record about, you know, Revelations and all that stuff. And I didn't know that till after the name was chosen.
You cone.
Brian. Brian.
Yeah.
What's up, man? You're 20 on Love Hunt.
Yeah, I just want to know if you guys are putting out any more live CDs or anything like you did before.
Yeah,
like
Boxcar's never put out a live CD.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And when is this?
Oh. No, I said we never have. Like, it doesn't exist, yeah.
What? Oh, I'm talking about Blink.
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. This is a Boxcar thing.
Yeah, this is a Boxcar interview. But
you idiot!
Oh, that's messed up.
All right. Brian, are you driving a car right now?
No, a truck.
He's cruising.
A truck.
Yeah. He's loaded.
But to answer his question, though, I mean, Blink might, but, yeah, that's for a different interview. We want to come back and talk about that later. I got some more things to say to kids about
Blink.
About Blink at a different time.
All right, Angela has a question about your first band. No, Angela?
Yeah.
What's up? You're 18.
Yeah, well, I was just wondering, okay, me and my boyfriend been sexually active for a while now, and we first started out using condoms, but we stopped, and it's been a while now since we use them, but we've been using the withdrawal method, and I haven't gotten pregnant, and I was just wondering, like, if there could be something wrong with him or me.
No, you've just been lucky.
What's with
meaning coming, taking his penis out before he ejaculates? But there's a lot of semen emitted prior to ejaculation, so
it's called the pre-cum, Dr.
Yes,
Drew.
Indeed it is. And so, Angela, you're going to get pregnant.
Technical term.
It's so hard to go back after taking, like, using condoms, and then you and your old lady stop using them. Mm. That's tough. It feels amazing. It feels ridiculous.
Well, it's really it's interesting.
It's dangerous.
It's interesting about how it feels.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about that. Some.
It's juicy yet hot.
It feels like jelly.
Angela,
like
jelly. I beg of you not to get pregnant. I beg of you, sister. No, are you trying to? You're not married?
No, I'm not trying.
Why don't you get on the birth control pill? Or take a shot or a pad?
What's up with the guy thing? Are guys
coming soon?
What is it going to be? Please don't make it painful.
No, it's going to be. Are we going to get bloated? I'm afraid guys are going to say, yeah, I took my pill. I took it. And then.
Hey, I don't want to get bloated and be moody. All these Boxcar songs are going to be like, you know, today the guy at the grocery store said something bad to me, made me mad or whatever. Am I going to have to, like, sit down with my friends and tell them all about my day and everything and just go, and then this guy, like, it was crazy, you know?
Most of you are going to talk about your other friends to your friends.
Yeah.
Is it going to be a pill you have to take at a certain time every single day?
Can it be an ointment? That would be great.
Ugh.
Everything should be an ointment.
Everything.
Preventative ointments for everything.
If Angela, we will never get that thing.
How about a suppository?
It's coming, right? How about a preventative ointment, Angela? What about something for you?
Preventative ointment, I like that.
I've never thought about that.
You've never thought about being on the pill?
No.
Have you been to a gynecologist before?
No.
All right, you have to get pelvic exams if you're sexually active. You understand that someone your age who is sexually active is at risk for cervical cancer, right?
Yeah.
How come?
Mm-hmm.
That's anyone, more than one partner, beginning and sex at an early age, these are all risk factors for cervical cancer.
For cervical cancer?
And just being under 25 is a risk for cervical cancer. Look about half.
Have you had a pelvic exam?
Basically, half the population out there has got the wart virus, and the wart virus seems to be what causes cervical cancer.
Really?
Wart virus.
Wow. A virus can cause cancer?
Oh, yeah.
What's a wart virus?
Travis, show him what.
Genital warts. Really? The
wart.
Travis, let me see it.
No, I've actually been pretty fortunate.
My words pop.
Yeah. No. For I don't know. I've always been protected though. I've been a safety boy, but you know.
Yeah, Angela, you've got to get some contraceptive going here, and you've got to get your regular health care done because it's very serious. And cervical cancer, once it gets going, is quite deadly.
That's gnarly.
Yeah.
It's so gnarly.
Angela, you seem like you're hearing this and it's going right out your ear, huh?
No, I was just wondering because he thinks that he might be sterile.
You're
just
Angela, you're lucky. You're going to get pregnant. Call Planned Parenthood. Get an appointment. Go in there. Okay.
You sound like you want a kid. Mm-hmm. And believe me, you don't unless you're ready. Because I'm ready, and it's hard.
1-800-230-PLAN. PLAN. All right. It's not, what's funny
get
about
on the
this
pill.
Is not
go to a
funny.
Doctor and get a pill.
This is not funny. This is your life we're talking about here. It's not funny.
It's screwing up our lives when she has the kid. That's what it's going to do.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right, Angela.
All right, thanks.
Okay, bye. Good luck with that. Damn. Maureen.
Yeah?
What's up? You're 14.
Uh-huh.
Okay, go ahead.
First of all, Blink, you guys, Boxcar Race, you guys rule. I love you guys so much. And I have a question about... quitting smoking,
mm-hmm.
and like, what's the best way?
It's the best thing for
Travis,
you.
Travis, I just did. This is Travis. I quit smoking like
this is Travis.
A month? No, a month and a week ago, and it was I got super duper sick. I had like bronchitis, and then 3 days after whatever my bronchitis was over, I just quit. I don't know. It's so hard, but quit cold turkey. Don't do any of that. I don't know. One of my boys got hypnotized. I don't know. You could do it. You just got to be strong. Like, you know, you got to...
It's willpower.
Yeah, willpower. You just got to make it. It's a poor excuse to smoke. Like, I said the same thing. Like, my favorite song came on. I wanted to have a cigarette. Like, whatever. I was bummed out about something. Have a cigarette. Like, smoking's so bad for you. It's retarded. I don't know.
It's dumb.
So bad.
It is dumb.
Well...
It's
she just got cut off.
Oh, sorry.
But sorry. Don't smoke.
Too many uses of the S word.
Yeah, too much. Too much. Drew, what's your advice for quitting, since you're the addiction medicine guy?
Yeah. What I always ask my patients is, are they ready? Have you really made up your mind? Have you set a date? You ready to go?
Yeah, I got to the point where, like, you know, like, you don't want to have your hands smell like cigarettes, your clothes, you smell awful.
Well, it took me, like, three times to quit.
The more times you try, the more likely you are to be successful.
Yeah.
I don't see any problem with the gums and the patches and stuff. It does seem to help people with some of the withdrawal symptoms.
But you know what it is, though, Dr. Drew, is that people, like friends of mine, that go in and talk to doctors, and they'll tell them, don't quit cold turkey, and that just gives them an excuse keep smoking.
No, you quit cold turkey with cigarettes. You pick a date, that is it. You stop.
Yeah, that's what I thought, and that's
absolutely
what I did. And
absolutely. There's no such thing as a drug, really, you can taper successfully down from. It just doesn't exist.
Right. You know what that sounds like that makes me bummed out? Is this? There's so many doctors that I don't think are educated in so many different things.
Right.
They think they know everything. Like, if someone wanted to quit cigarettes, I think it would be rad if they talked to him, Dr. Drew, because he knows about it. Like, it's crazy. For example, my wife was anemic. She didn't have enough iron. Mm. So the doctor's like, okay, you got to have, like, all these prescription iron pills and all this stuff. And it totally messes you up and makes you sick if you have it.
Constipated.
Yeah, and she's just like, okay, I want to have this organic, like, all vegetable iron stuff. And they're like, no, oh, my God, you can't do that or whatever. You're going to hurt your baby. And then she went and did it. And then everything was just perfect. And they're like, what are you doing? It's just because they didn't know. You know, and it sucks to think that someone wants to stop smoking so they don't die, and he's like, don't do that. And
Travis, have you been told that before?
My doctor rules. My doctor at home, like, I don't go to his office, I go to his house, because he hooks it up like that. But I've been there and gone, like, man, should I quit smoking while I'm sick? And he'll lean over and have a pack of cigarettes in his pocket. He goes, well, I'm a doctor, I still smoke. Like, you prick. Like, it makes it so hard for me to quit smoking because you still smoke. And you're a doctor.
The gnarliest thing I've ever seen, though, is our doctor for our band. He's a surgeon. He's a head, neck, throat surgeon. And he brings home these slides of operations of tumors that he takes out of the back of people's throats and heads.
From cigarettes.
From cigarettes.
Yeah.
The gnarliest thing that you don't see this stuff like on TV and stuff. You just hear people go, yeah, you know, you get sick from smoking cigarettes. But, dude, I've seen the pictures. It's the gnarliest thing I've ever seen. Never seen anything like that. Like,
and there is there are other medicines help with the cravings, Zyban and things, if you're really having trouble
that's
stopping.
That's supposed to work good.
It does work. It does work. But the really important thing is deciding on a date and doing it. And there are... Smoke Enders programs, you know, sometimes help too.
Have you had patients come to you that have been to other doctors and those doctors have been so off and you're like, what the hell are these guys doing?
Well, people don't, my profession and this country has a grave, grave misunderstanding about addiction of all types. I mean, people, it's amazing how little people know about it. And I was one of them. When I used to pat heroin addicts in the back, yeah, you get move out of that neighborhood, you'll be fine. You know, I totally had no effing idea what it was about. And I got very involved in that field. And now I can see how little. For some reason, our culture wants it to make it everyone's problem. It's their fault because they get strung out.
What's the number one false rumor of someone that's addicted? Like, is it the that way they quit?
That it's a moral issue or that it's a weakness. It could not be further from the reality.
It's something in your brain that's wired like that.
It's a brain disease. And it's you know, people that work with all the time, it is so obvious to us and it's so apparent how it's so bizarre, how we get it so wrong in the world. So... Right.
We do have to take a break. Speaking of addicted, we're going to talk about the gene and if you can skip it, if it's been in your family and all that, and more with Boxcar Racer and Drew and me, Stryker, coming up on Loveline. Hey, we're back here on Loveline. Boxcar Racer is here. Dr. Drew, it's me, Stryker. We only have a few more minutes, and there's a question here for Anthony and David. Daisy.
Yeah?
What's up? You're on. You're 14.
Okay, yeah. I had a question for Anthony and David. I want to know how it is for them to be on the band. How do they feel?
It's awesome.
It feels awesome?
It's awesome. It's like, it's like your dream coming true, you know? Like whatever you want to do and succeed or whatever, and you finally get to do that, and get the opportunity to do that, it's really, really cool.
How did you guys get hooked up with Tom and or Travis? Who knew who?
Dave's like Tom's girlfriend.
I'm like Tom's girlfriend. Yeah. Thanks for putting it that
basically,
way.
Basically, yeah.
It's more a physical relationship than emotional. Yeah.
You're gay.
We all grew up together in different ways. Like Tom and Dave grew up together. Me and Anthony grew up together.
Yeah.
They grew up in the 619.
And we grew up in the 909.
Got it.
So. Well, yeah, we had some, we had gated communities.
Yeah.
We had Baskin-Robbins.
We had lowriders and drive-bys.
You have any more questions, Daisy?
I wanted to congratulate Tom. DeLonge, did I say that right?
It's actually
DeLonge.
it's DeLong, but okay. That's only because they started mispronouncing it in my family. It's supposed to be DeLonge or DeLonge.
Oh, okay.
Whatever, what have you? You can use whatever one you would like.
Oh, and I wanted to congratulate you for Ava.
Thank you very much.
She's gorgeous.
Thank you.
And I was gonna ask you for a little favor.
Yes.
My birthday is in 2 weeks.
Uh huh.
And I want to know if you could sing to me with your gorgeous, seductive, dreamy voice.
In now or in two weeks?
What key do you want it in? Because that's really how I work.
Because no matter what you ask, it'll be either under or over. Yeah.
Yeah.
Be sharp.
However you feel like going for
it. You know what I mean? Like happy birthday, Mr. President, kind of thing.
Okay.
Is it your name's Daisy, right?
Yeah.
You want to do it right now?
Sing of the rap. Sing of the rap.
Go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Go. Happy birthday, Daisy.
Daisy.
Happy birthday to you. Wait, hold on. No. Hey. You.
Happy birthday, you're not special.
Yeah, very good. How about happy that, birthday. Daisy?
Oh, thank you so much.
Take it easy.
I love you guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Oh, that's cool. All right, let's get some more band stuff. Shannon.
Yeah?
15. Oh, no, we just answered that question. How did you all meet? Okay.
That one.
There we go. Yeah, quickly. That's right. I did promo this. Katie.
Yeah.
Drew is now salivating again
real
because
quick.
Of your question. You're 19.
Real quick. You want to ask if the gene can skip?
Yeah.
Well, it's 50. Whether one or both parent have the gene, it's about 50% per child, the risk.
What if the history goes back, like, hundreds of years?
Are you North American Indian?
I'm Cherokee and Irish.
That's the one exception.
What are we talking about?
Is it really?
The gene for alcoholism addiction.
That still goes back to my grandpa's.
Yeah, the Cherokee family system is the ones where I've seen the penetrance of the gene approaching more like 100%. In other words, rather than being 50-50 like it is in most of the European descents, it's higher. and that you, well, you'll get families where all the siblings have it, kind of thing. So that North American Indian genetics is, yeah, is a higher, particularly
the funny
Cherokee.
Thing about it though, because all three of my sisters have the addiction gene.
Well,
and
does
I
it?
Don't.
I understand. Then count your blessings. You didn't get it. Doesn't mean it has to be 100%, but it tends to approach 100% in that situation.
Okay.
What a white Caucasian dudes have.
Depends. Well, they have all kinds of weird stuff. but it's funny. It's populations that have been through multiple generations of severe military kinds of assaults. That's where you see the alcoholism gene very highly
weird.
Present.
And on that note, we're going to take another quick break.
Yep.
And when we come back, a couple more words with the guys from Boxcar Racer on Loveline. Yes, we're back on Loveline. A couple more minutes here with Boxcar Racer. Let's get some of the dates out that you're going to be playing real quick. I have them in front of me. 23rd, which could be the first date of the tour, but maybe not, of October. Going to be in Tucson at the Rialto. Going to be in Austin on the 26th. Where else? Chicago on the 9th. There's going to be dates before that as well, of course. The 16th of November, Salt Lake City. The L.A. shows, the 23rd of November and the 24th of November. BoxcarRacer.com has all the information. And congrats, you guys, on everything so far.
Thank you.
You guys are doing really well.
Thank you very much.
I don't know if it's bigger than you thought or what, but, man, I really, really like the songs and the sound. And I can tell that there is a difference between the Blink sound and the Boxcar Racer sound. Anthony and David, you guys are special young men.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You're a good-looking dude.
Thank you.
Special young
Travis,
man.
You're a fine young man also.
Oh, thank you.
Tom. I don't know,
what?
You asshole. You're good.
Oh,
dick.
Okay, people, enough.
Oh, my God. Tomorrow on Loveline, Sherry Appleby is going to be here, and then the following night, Weezer is going to be here.
Who's Sherry Appleby?
Roswell.
Well, Brownhill.
Yes.
She started that Applebee's restaurant chain? You guys are expanding your horizons here.
Yeah, exactly. So have a good tour. Have a good time.
Thank you.
Be safe, and we will see you guys tomorrow. Drew, is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
That's it. All right, for Dr. Drew, I'm sorry.
Whoa. We need to stall for at least 10 seconds.
Oh, we did? Oh, okay. Well, the clock is here. It's not over. Oh, by the way, just to give you guys some more info, who broke the clock in here? David?
Dave.
Yeah, Dave from Boxcar Racer broke the clock.
He thought there was a PB&J inside of it. I think that we're in a big...
That's a joke from earlier.
He's addicted to skinny.
It's a really tiny room in here.
It's a very small room. It is so hot in here right now. You guys don't even know. Her? Where's your sweater, Travis? Have fun with your new lady. She's better than the old one, apparently.
Apparently.
As everyone said. All right, yeah. That's going to do it. Boxcar Racer, strike for Adam. Andrew saying, see you later.
My penis tastes great.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.